God of all glory, on this first day you began creation, bringing light out of darkness.
On this first day you began your new creation, raising Jesus Christ from the darkness of death.
On this Lord's day, grant that we, the people you create by water and the Spirit, may be joined with all your works in praising you for your great glory.
God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and free. Alleluia. Amen.
Thank you.
You may be seated now for the scripture reading, which comes to us from the second chapter of Exodus, verses 1 through 10. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a paper basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrew's children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses, because she said, "I drew him out of the water."
sanctuary to go to their time that they say. May God be with you there. And the children and the teachers reply, may God be with you here. So let's practice. The congregation will say, may God be with you there. And the kids get to be kind of loud because there are more of them than there are people. You ready? May God be with you here. Could you guys hear them?
Yes.
Let's try one more time, because I couldn't. Just me, just for me.
May God be with you here.
Thank you. Nicely done. All right. You guys can head off to Sunday school. Our second scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke. And if you can't hear me, maybe just wave your hand at Jake, and he's going to work on the levels a little bit this morning for us. Our text comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verse 36 to 38. There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, this is the moment when Simeon has sung his song to Jesus. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Israel. The word of the Lord for us today.
Thanks be to God.
As our oh God, as our ancestors have listened to your word and trusted in you, let us, by your Spirit, hear your word for us today and give us grace to trust in you. Amen. Today, as many of you, I'm sure, are aware, is Mother's Day here in the United States. It's a day that we hopefully sent a card or some flowers. Maybe we made breakfast or we have lunch plans later. But as someone who has experienced loss myself in a miscarriage and said goodbye to my grandmothers, today is also a day of heartache for many. And today I want to talk a bit about this experience of mothering as a way of talking about faith. In the book of Hebrews, faith is described as the assurance of things hoped for. It's described when the letter talks about patriarchs as actions that they take, showing what they hope for. They believe that God will do what God has said, and so they act in a particular way. Our faith is not merely what we say or even what we think, but it's how we act, what we do, how we care for our neighbors, how we show courage in the face of pain and fear, how we stand up for the values of God's household, justice, peacemaking, caring for those who are left out of our society, proclaiming good news. And the unfortunate truth is that in the history of the church, the Big C Church, there are many who have expressed faith with eloquent words, but those words have been hollow, because their actions show them out to be people of a much different kind of faith. These stories that we've read and heard read are stories about mothering. I think about mothering as the work of creating, of nurturing, and protecting. There's a book in my office called Mother God. It's a children's book, and it has these beautiful illustrations of the ways that God is described as a mother, as mothering in the Bible. My favorite is God described as a mother bear, and it's an illustration of a mother bear with her teeth bared, protecting her young cubs. I am in awe of the work of so many who have created, who have nurtured, who have protected, who've acted out mothering. I started to think about today, Mother's Day, a little differently when I met my friend Claire. Claire is from London, And in the United Kingdom, they celebrate a version of Mother's Day, but they call it Mothering Sunday. It's a day when they remember all of those who have been creative in their lives, who have nurtured them, who have protected them. And Claire is my example of mothering. Claire is a mom. She has three kids. And her youngest, when she was 2.5 years old, went to the doctor. It was during the H1N1 pandemic, if you remember that. And she got her vaccine. Claire thought that she was taking good care of her daughter, and she was. And her daughter just happened to be one of, as it turns out, several hundred children in Europe who had an adverse reaction to that vaccine. And she developed narcolepsy and cataplexy. Narcolepsy is a disease where you fall asleep often, and cataplexy is a disease where you lose control of your body and you can hear and sense the world around you, but you can't move or respond to it. You can imagine a 2-year-old starting to have these kinds of symptoms was terrifying for her. And so Claire took her to the hospital immediately and spent the next, I think, 3 years advocating for her daughter to be treated, to find out what it could be. At first, they thought it was a brain tumor. Then they thought it was another series of neurological symptoms. I'm sure many of you have this experience where suddenly you were faced with a health challenge and nobody quite seems to know what's going on. And in the fear and frustration, Claire kept going. She wasn't getting any sleep. She and her husband had to be up at all hours of the day and the night to take care of their daughter. But she persevered, and today her daughter is graduating from high school this year, and she found a doctor in the United States at Stanford University who could identify what she had. Turns out that she's one of the youngest children ever recorded to have developed narcolepsy, usually develops in adolescence. And so they went through a series of challenges getting her medication and getting her treated. Her daughter has always been brilliant and creative, and I'm so grateful to have been a part of their life's journey, to see the ways that when you advocate and care and protect, you can build someone's life up. The incredible faith that Claire had, that there was a future for her daughter that she couldn't yet see, is the kind of faith that these women in our stories today. And I'm not sure how many of you have read the story of Moses being born recently. I know it's not one that I have read in recent memory, and I have a age where we had felt boards in Sunday school, so I actually remember felt Moses being put in the ark. I want to back up, though, and tell you a bit about the midwives who came before in chapter 1. So as you'll remember, Joseph has led his family into Egypt because there was a famine, and they find a place to live, and they are raised up in the household of Pharaoh because Joseph has proven his worth to Pharaoh as such an able manager. But things change. That Pharaoh dies, another Pharaoh comes, and the new Pharaoh doesn't remember Joseph and starts to see these people who are not Egyptians, who have a different faith, a different way of being in the world than his people, as outsiders, as troublemakers, as people who threaten him. In this story, Pharaoh is unnamed, which is interesting for what's to come. What we know about Pharaoh is that Pharaoh is afraid. And so in his fear, as many of us do, Pharaoh makes a series of pretty awful decisions. Pharaoh decides that the only way to keep these people from being fruitful and multiplying, a callback to the Genesis narrative, God's command to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth, That's what these people have done. So he thinks, I know, I will kill all the male babies. Well, how am I going to do that? He calls on two midwives, and the midwives are named in our story, Shipra and Pua. And he says to them, let the girls, children who are born live, but kill all the baby boys. Shipra and Pua are described as women who fear God more than they fear Pharaoh. And so they don't do what Pharaoh says to do. Of course, Pharaoh is enraged when he calls them back into his court and says, why haven't you done what I asked you to do? And Shipra and Pua very cleverly say, we just can't get there in time. The Hebrew women, they give birth too quickly. They don't call for us. They're not like the Egyptian women who are delicate and need help and labor. Now, aside from throwing the Egyptian women under the bus, because labor is hard for everyone, they play upon Pharaoh's prejudices. Pharaoh is already imagining that the Hebrews are different than the Egyptians, and so he dismisses them, and they leave having saved untold numbers of Hebrew baby boys. Now, Pharaoh gives a new order. He says to all of the citizens, throw the babies into the Nile, the Hebrew baby boys into the Nile. And here we come to Moses' mother. Moses' mother gives birth. She notices that her baby boy is beautiful. That's the rendering in some translations. And I can imagine after giving birth, she sees this baby, knows that it's a boy, knows the danger in the situation, and then looks in his face and sees he's beautiful and makes a different decision. Trusting in God, who has made all of these promises to God's people, she hides Moses for 3 months. I can't imagine having an 8-month-old myself trying to hide a baby. They're loud. They need lots of things. Everyone wants to come and see them. But she does it. She hides Moses for 3 months. And then she actually follows Pharaoh's instruction. She does cast her baby into the Nile. But she casts her baby into the Nile by forming an ark, just as Noah built an ark to protect the animals and his family. Moses' mother builds an ark. She lines it with tar and sets it afloat with her daughter following close behind. We don't know from this story if Moses knew that Pharaoh's daughter bathed in the river. We don't know if Miriam walked along behind it, pushing the ark to try to make its way, or if that's just where Moses ended up. But Pharaoh's daughter enters the story, and she's bathing, and she hears the cry of a baby. Now, in my Sunday school class, when the teacher told this, she made sort of a noise for Moses. Again, I have an 8-month-old. Moses is wailing because he's hungry from this ark, and probably terrified, not knowing where he is. Pharaoh's daughter hears the baby, goes, lifts him out, and she doesn't notice his beauty. Instead, Pharaoh's daughter notices his vulnerability, and she has compassion on this baby because Pharaoh's daughter knows what her father has ordered. Pharaoh's daughter knows the consequences of disobeying a Pharaoh, and yet she takes compassion. Even though she doesn't have faith in God's promises, she knows that there's something wrong with the way that her father is treating these people. And so she decides to take the baby out of the ark. Moses' sister comes up. And as I was doing reading this week, I read a book by a professor from Princeton Theological Seminary. Her name's Jack Lapsley. And she highlighted this question that Miriam asked that I hadn't noticed before. Miriam comes forward, and there are lots of questions she could have asked of Pharaoh's daughter, but she asks, would you like me to find a Hebrew woman to nurse him for you? Miriam For she at least is pushing Pharaoh's daughter to acknowledge that Pharaoh's daughter is going to take care of this baby. Because you don't need a wet nurse if you're not going to care for the baby. Miriam accelerates what might have been a longer decision on Pharaoh's daughter's part. Because Miriam sees the compassion in her eyes and knows that her baby brother will be safe. All of these women in this story are showing us the kind of mothering that is creative, that is protecting, that is nurturing. And they're showing us a kind of faith in the face of real danger with serious consequences. Pharaoh's daughter is disobeying her father. Miriam and Moses' mother are disobeying the Pharaoh, and the midwives are doing the same. Their faith leads them to action. It's marked by a fear of God over a fear of other consequences. It leads them to nonviolent disobedience to an unjust ruler. It shows courage and persistence. It shows obedience to God. And it shows that that kind of faith leads to deliverance for the people of God. We know later the person that Moses will become, but because of these people in Moses' life, Moses isn't able to step into the call that God has for Moses. Our next story of a mother in faith is Anna. Anna, as we have learned, has been a widow for 77 years. She was only with her husband for 7, and from that time has been living in the temple, praying and fasting. What we know about early Second Temple Judaism is that you would go to the temple to live if you didn't have family to take care of you. So Anna is in a precarious position, and she trusts and leans into who God is and God's promises to throw herself at the temple for her well-being. She's in the temple when Simeon meets Jesus when Jesus is a baby. And she listens to Simeon's song declaring, "This is the redemption of Israel." And Anna, because she has spent so many years waiting and trusting and praying and fasting for this child, when she sees him, her immediate reaction is to start talking to everyone around her and say, this is Jesus, the Messiah, the redemption of Israel. Her faith leads her to go and tell the whole world that she has seen God's promises fulfilled. So faith, friends, is the evidence of what we hope for. It's shown by our words and our actions. It's shown in our care and our protection of others. It's shown in the ways that we go and tell the good news to our neighbors, to our friends, and to strangers. I'm sure that you all have stories of folks who have mothered you in your lives, those who have protected you, who have nurtured you, who have been creative with you. This church, as we saw last week with the installation of the Leadership for Presbyterian Women, has many who are invested in the protection and care and nurturing of this community of faith. As I mentioned last week, part of our work together during this interim time is thinking back on our heritage. And so I invite you this week to think of a story, of a person, of a feeling even, someone who encouraged, who was creative with you, who nurtured you, who protected you. Lift that story up to God in prayer, giving thanks, and reminding yourself of their faith that's been passed on to you. And then imagine how you can show that kind of faith in this community, in your places of work, in your neighborhoods, in the places that you occupy around Fayetteville and Peachtree City and Sonoya and wherever else we're all from. I want to close with a prayer from Kate Bowler. Kate's a professor at Duke, and she's written a series of blessings that I really appreciate because they are honest and truthful. Sometimes the content of our words, especially as Presbyterians, is beautiful. We are masterful with our language in saying just the right things about God. But sometimes those things are a bit vague, and they don't ground us in faith. So this is a prayer that Kate has written about honest faith to close this reflection. Let's pray. God, I am disappointed and embarrassed at what people get up to in the name of religion. My heart is thirsty for a faith I can trust, and I mean that. I don't trust the cultural scripts that turn religion into a game where somebody wins and somebody loses, and there's a strong sense of the entrepreneur. Somebody is sowing something. And from the recesses of my mind, from some very early encounter, I think I must have met the real you, God. But somehow I met goodness so pure it settled my heart to understand trustworthiness of a majesty and stature that thereafter I could accept no counterfeits. God, come show yourself again. Show me faith that cannot be faked. Let me see you in the loveliness of others, living out their faith so genuinely, so honestly that you shine through. And if I can't get all the theology right, let me not worry too long. I suspect you'd rather I live honestly by the light of what I know to do that looks most like you and keep quiet about the rest. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
In 656,
We will continue our service with the affirmation of faith together, saying, "We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and religious to the captives, teaching by word and deed, and blessing the children, healing the sick, and binding up the brokenhearted, eating without pests, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned by blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain, and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to eternal life. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, Come, Lord Jesus."
Now, as we receive the gifts and the talents of this congregation, will you join me in a prayer of thanksgiving? Gracious God, we give you thanks for the blessings that you have poured out on us, for the gifts of those who have supported and cared and nurtured and protected us. Will you take these offerings of our time and our talent and our treasure to be for the upbuilding of your kingdom on earth. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The joy of all the mothers present.
We give you great thanks for your hard work. Let's lift up our prayers of joy and sorrow to God. God, you hear our hearts' cries. You know what weighs heavy on us and what brings us joy, that makes us light as air. We pray that you would be at work bringing about healing and restoration, reconciliation and relationships, welcome and peace, that you would be particularly with those who are in the hospital and recovering from surgery this week. We pray, God, that you would strengthen us for the work of showing our faith ahead. And we give thanks for the inspiration of those who have gone before us. We pray all of this in the power of your Holy Spirit that sends us out. Amen. Friends, go in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And as you go out this morning, I invite you to share the peace with one another, and in particular to say hello to someone that you haven't said hello to this morning. Go in peace.